This is part two of a series on recurrent neural networks. In this video, we will look at backpropagation through time, BPTT. This video was produced in Korean and translated into English. My voice is generated by AI, text-to-speech. In the last video, we looked at the basic concepts of recurrent neural networks and how to construct a dataset. In this tutorial, we will look at the basic types of recurrent neural networks and backpropagation through time. And let's see what problems arise during backpropagation of recurrent neural networks. First, let's look at the many-to-one structure, which is the most basic form of recurrent neural networks. As we saw in the previous video, the training dataset for RNN looks like this. Feature X is a three-dimensional structure. A subset contains a sequence of data points over a period of time. The first dimension is the batch size, which is the number of subsets. The next dimension is the number of time steps, i.e. the number of sequences. And the last dimension is the number of features. This is a dataset for time series forecasting. The target Y is a two-dimensional array. The first dimension is the batch size, which is the number of subsets. And the second dimension is the number of features. Each row is the output for each subset of features. Each row is the data point following the last data point in each subset. Each subset X is the input to an RNN, and the target Y is the output. When you feed multiple data points to an RNN, it outputs one data point. This is a data set for many-to-one structure. The target Ys are real numbers, so it's a regression problem. You can also use RNNs to perform classification. For example, the MNIST dataset is as follows. Each MNIST image corresponds to a subset of features, which is a 28 by 28 matrix. And each row of target Y is a category for each subset. Analyzing the MNIST dataset with RNNs assumes that the rows in each subset are dependent on each other. Now, let's look at the structure of an RNN. As we saw in the previous video, an RNN can be unfolded as follows. RNN basically has trainable parameters of WX, WH, and WO. Although not shown in the figure, there are also biases. The above dataset is fed into this RNN. For more information on this figure, please refer to the previous video. This can be expressed simply as follows. Since there are five sequence data points in a subset, the number of recurrent time steps in the RNN is also five. The data points in each subset are fed into the RNN at each time step. And at each time step, the output Z of the recurrent layer is computed as follows. The WX is the weights matrix between the input layer and the recurrent layer. And BH is the bias vector of the recurrent layer. HT minus 1 is the output of the previous recurrent layer, and its initial value is 0. WH is the weights matrix of the recurrent layer. Taking the activation function F for this Z gives H, which is the output of the recurrent layer at each time step. H is fed into the next time step. The output of the last time step is fed into the existing feedforward network. This feedforward network performs regression or classification. For time series forecasting, it performs regression. The past information is passed along H to the last time step. At the final time step, past and present information are combined and passed to the feedforward network. the output of the feedforward network is the predicted value of y, i.e. y hat. We compute the loss L using the target value y and the predicted value y hat. This is a many-to-one RNN model. As the gradient of the loss L is backpropagated, the parameters WO, WH, and WX are updated. At the last time step, WO, WH, and WX are updated as the gradients propagate to the lower layers. At the fourth time step, WH and WX are updated as the gradient backpropagates in this way. The gradient continues to backpropagate until the first time step, updating WH and WX. WO is updated once, and WH and WX are updated 5 times during backpropagation. They are not actually updated 5 times, but only once after the gradients are combined. To help you understand, I've expressed it as updated 5 times. We'll look at this backpropagation in more detail after a while. Next, let's look at the many-to-many structure. The structure of the dataset is like this. The feature subsets are the same as those for many-to-one, but the structure of the target Y is different. In many-to-many, the target Y also has a three-dimensional structure. As with feature subsets, the first dimension is the number of subsets. The second is the number of time steps. And the third is the number of features. Each row of target Y is the next data point of each row of feature X. If data point number 1 is input at time step 1, data point number 2 will be output at that time step. And if data point number 2 is input at time step 2, data point number 3 will be output at that time step. Likewise, the target Y is also sequence data. Now let's look at the structure of the network. This is identical to the many-to-one structure, but Y is output at each time step. When the first data point of the feature subset is input to the first time step, the predicted value of the first data point of the target Y is output through the recurrent layer and the output layer. And the loss L1 of the first step is computed using the target Y and the predicted Y hat. Then the gradients of the loss L1 are backpropagated to the lower layers to update WO, WH, and WX. At the second time step, the loss L2 is also computed, and the gradients of L2 are backpropagated to the lower layers, updating WO, WH, and WX again. In fact, they are not updated multiple times, but only once after the gradients are combined. The gradients of L2 with respect to WH are also backpropagated to the previous time step. This is backpropagation through time, BPTT. We will look at this in more detail on the next page. Then WH will be updated at the first time step like this. This process is repeated in this way until the final step. This is a many-to-many RNN structure. For time series forecasting, the outputs of the final time step can be used as the predicted values. Next, let's look at the backpropagation in RNNs. In RNNs, the gradients are backpropagated to previous time steps, which is called backpropagation through time, BPTT. First, let's think about backpropagation in a feed-forward network. For more details about it, please watch this video. Let's consider the backpropagation for a single pass as follows. The weight W2 is updated like this by gradient descent. And the gradient of L with respect to W2 can be written like this by the chain rule. The weight W1 is also updated as follows. Let's say these are the connections between time steps in an RNN. Then W1 and W2 will be the same as WH in an RNN. Let's call this W. That is, W is a common weight. If so, B will be updated once here, and then once more here. That is, W will be updated twice. Alternatively, we can combine the gradients this way, updating W once and getting the same result. Now let's look at the backpropagation in RNN. Parameters WX and WO are also updated by backpropagation, but we will only consider WH of the recurrent layer. The gradient of the loss L with respect to WH at the last time step is backpropagated like this. Since the gradient flows in the time direction, it is called backpropagation through time. In the many-to-one case, the gradient is backpropagated like this. In the many-to-many case, the gradients at each time step are combined and backpropagated together. Then WH is updated once here, and once more here. In this figure, WH is updated 3 times. Again, in reality, the gradients are combined to update WH once. The final loss L is as follows. The losses of each time step are added together. And the output HT at time step T is computed as follows. This formula includes H of T minus 1, which is the output of the previous time step. That is, HT is a recursive function. FH is an activation function of the recurrent layer. WH is updated like this by gradient descent. Now let's find the gradient of loss L with respect to WH. This can be expressed in chain rule as follows. The first two factors are easy to compute, but the last factor is a little tricky to compute. This is because HT is a recursive function. Now let's focus on the partial derivative HT with respect to WH. As you can see on the left, this breaks down into 2 terms. And this term breaks down into 2 terms again. This term continues to break down into 2 terms until it reaches the first step. This can be expressed like this. Let's think about the recurrence relation like this. AT minus 1 breaks down into 2 terms like this. And AT minus 2 breaks down into 2 terms again. This can be expressed like this. Therefore, the above equation can also be expressed as follows. Let's just look at this part. In the above equation, the partial derivative of HJ with respect to HJ minus 1 is WH times FH prime. And since WH is common to all time steps, we can take it out of the product symbol like this. If I is 1, WH is multiplied T minus 2 times. And FH prime is also multiplied T minus 2 times. Now let's interpret this. When WH is greater than 1, this value increases exponentially as the time step size increases. That is, the gradient is exploding. Conversely, if WH is less than 1 or FH prime is less than 1, this value decreases exponentially. That is, the gradient is vanishing. If f is sigmoid or hyperbolic tangent, the vanishing gradient occurs because f prime is less than 1. In the case of feedforward networks, only the gradients backpropagated along this path are considered. But in RNNs, the gradients backpropagated along the time past also be considered, so the gradients either vanish or explode more. Due to these issues, training can become unstable in simple RNNs if the time step size is set too large. That is, it becomes difficult to learn dependencies from the distant past. This is a drawback of simple RNNs. To solve this problem, truncated BPTT was also designed. Additionally, LSTM, GRU, etc., which will be examined later, have also been proposed. The source for these expressions is this document. So far, we have looked at the many-to-one and many-to-many structures of RNNs and the backpropagation through time. In the next video, we will implement a simple RNN in code.